we're on camera. Being the right time and a quorum, we call the meeting to order. Public input. No one from the public here. We'll move right to minutes. For the record, this is the meeting of December 15th, 2016. Entertain a motion.
I will make the motion that we accept the minutes.
Of September 29. Any comments, questions, changes? No?
Not on that one.
I was thinking if you seconded it, it would save
time. Yeah, I made the motion. That was...
Okay. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any nays? It is unanimous. The next item is the minutes of November 17th.
I'll make a motion and we accept the minutes. I think someone else has to second
it. I'll second it, but I had a couple of...
Okay.
Nothing important, and I already gave the... just a couple of typos.
Oh.
On page 3 and 4, and I gave that information to Sid already.
So the rest of it's all solid? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The ayes have it. Executive Director's report.
Well, it's kind of overall, it's a good news, bad news report in some respects. We did sell a bit of water this summer, which certainly helped our budget this year. But we are getting back to normal, which is still showing a trend that we're slightly below our average over the last couple of years. So we're still looking at budgeting for stability funds to allow for a slight decrease in our consumptions. And our 16-inch main interconnection with East Providence did get started this week. It's partially done. They ran into rock. So they're going to have to, we were hoping to get it done this week, they're going to be back into it next week.
A point about that, because we keep going back and forth about 16 inches versus 24 inches. My understanding is our part is going to be 24 inches, but tapping into a 16-inch main, right?
That's correct.
I would suggest that this be restated so a reasonable person reading it would get understand that.
Okay.
Because otherwise we're going to run into the same issue that Halsey was talking about, which is why begin something at 16 inches when it should be 24 inches. So mm-hmm. We're putting 24 inches to tap into 16, right?
Right. Okay. And then we will eventually extend the 24 to go
right
into...
Right, and you elsewhere you make that very clear, but not here.
These patterns. Okay. Generators on track, I believe, Ken, next week we're talking about.
Yes, being delivered, be installed in the first, second week of January.
How many kilowatts?
The big one here is 60 kW, across the street is 24.
And what's the total, cost?
Total cost in the whole pack, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, about $108,000.
Yeah. This has got the automatic switchover, right?
Transfer switch.
Everything
yes,
is automatic.
Right. And, I did want to say our thanks to Randy and Joe Granada. They did a lot of pre-preparation work, a lot of training up front. Our conversion on our software went very smoothly. Our employees are very happy with it. It's working out very well. And especially with our operations group, there's been a lot of improvements to the software package for the work order systems. It makes it a lot easier to use. So we're very enthusiastic to be able to get that up and running in a very short period of time.
Can I jump back a second under the meter system?
Sure.
It says we ordered the software is on order, along with meters for replacement installation as needed. Did we actually order some meters, or
we did.
How many did we order?
We ordered initially, we have 200 of the smaller meters coming in, and I ordered 3 large meters, which we are looking to replace on Roger Williams College. They have one of the big 6-inch
It was about 200 meters, a little bit more than 200.
Yeah, a little bit more than 200 meters, and the radio transmitters.
Just kidding.
210, 200, something
okay,
like that.
Okay, thank you.
I can give you the exact number after.
That, not necessary.
Any other questions? Comments? Okay. When does Michael Crawford come on officially?
He'll be starting right after New Year's.
Okay. Okay.
Before we leave her, are you done with your report?
Yes.
Just one question.
Sure.
Pam, a couple of months ago, there was some dialogue amongst the directors. This had to do with the lead poisoning out at Flint, Michigan, and there was some discussion that if we submitted some paperwork for funding, that we might be eligible. And I was wondering if you heard anything, or did we submit the paperwork, or are we eligible to get any monies to help us with
Nothing's actually been appropriated yet. The Congress was looking at appropriating some funding for Detroit and for the EPA, but their loan programs, they were looking at possibly doing some grant programs, but they were looking like they're going to limit those to people that have already exceeded the lead action levels and to disadvantaged communities. Otherwise, they were going to designate some funds through the Clean Water Finance Program, which we've used in the past, but we found that our bonding through the banking has been actually less expensive for us. So they're strictly talking loan programs, and it would be for removing lead services. At this point in time, we're not aware of any lead services in our system.
But there was some talk about lead and meters and stuff, so I thought maybe
we could use something for that, but actually there's SRF funding available for transferring out meters, but it's not any more benefit to us than going through a bond to do it.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, because I think you recollect we were exploring
yep.
the possibility. Thank you.
Okay.
And I have two questions. One is, I understand that Senator Reid has submitted legislation for a lot of funding for the replacement or removal of high-risk dams. I don't know if any of our dams fall into that category. It's something you might want to look at in terms of funding.
That would certainly help. We've actually been trying to work on removing our, which actually is classified as a dam, but is a dike on the upper Kikemewit, which was initially installed to prevent salt water moving upstream rather than to prevent water coming downstream. We've been found in non-compliance with the state with not having a full inspection program for that dam, but we've been trying to work with, as we've talked about before in these meetings, about removing that dam and trying to work with the state to see if we could do that. Save the Bay is very interested in having it removed to create a wetlands up a saltwater marsh eventually above our reservoir. The problem is the state wants to see some action on it within the next couple months. And
so we would like to see some action on the money they owe us. It seems to me that we have a perfect opportunity to get Save the Bay behind a PR campaign to get rid of them.
And we've been having some meetings with them. We've met with Warren, because the town of Warren has to agree to it, because they're between us and the town of Warren, we own all the land around that area. So,
has the town of Warren agreed to that?
The administration is in favor of it, but it has to have some further testing done on the water quality testing on the north side of the dam. And then we're developing a program to go to the town council. We would need their approval.
And then the second question I had was about this new hire, who looks as if he doesn't spend very much time anywhere. Are you concerned about that?
Not at all. He's a very high achiever. He works beyond his
Job description.
Job description. And so I was always looking for another challenge, and I look at it similar to what I did in the past.
All three of these jobs, he moved up each time.
He moved up each time. In this case, it's considered a move back because he is engineering manager, but it's in a, now we're moving him in more into the operations side with the idea that eventually he will replace Ken's position as operations manager, which would be comparable, but he would, you know, like to even move higher than that. And I said, even if it didn't work out here, he would be in an excellent position to work anywhere, you know, as a
well, that's nice for him. Higher
administration
place.
It's
not so nice for us, so I don't see that as a selling point.
For us, it's a very strong selling point. He'll make an excellent superintendent of operations. He'll make an excellent operations superintendent. And I'm not going to be here forever. And I feel he'd be a very strong candidate at that point for my position. So I think it's, I'm looking at essentially a succession plan for, three of the most important positions in this organization.
He's taking a step back.
Other than finance.
He's taking a step back because he sees a future.
He sees the future.
Well,
yes.
The money's better.
No, it'd be he's actually, well.
You guys are like professional athletes.
Unfortunately, there are not many people out there in that job market, in our field.
Not that many good left-handed pitches either.
it's becoming a very selective environment, mainly because of, especially in the operations area, because of the licensing requirements. You have to have worked in the field for at least 4 years before you could even get the license. And to find anyone with an engineering degree with that kind of experience is very rare.
Well, at least he's from within the area.
Mm-hmm.
He's in Pawtucket.
Gina, you had other questions?
The north, yeah, he's just north across the border.
It's not clear, it's not clear from looking at his resume that he hasn't, oh yes, it does, it's right at the top, okay. My other question is the salary. So he's taking a step backwards in terms of title, and is he taking a step backwards in terms of salary? Or
the salary's going to be relatively equivalent. Where he's taken a step back is we don't have a pension. He'll be in the 457 plan. He's leaving the state pension, which is pretty valuable to most people.
Maybe.
Well,
plus he'll be contributing to the
whole
plan.
He's only been in the state plan for 14 months, so
yeah.
He may not
well, it was one of his concerns. He has a family. So it's,
okay.
All right. Any other questions? Mark, you're up.
Great report, Mark.
Okay. A lot of what I'm going to do is going to be up here. So
that's okay. We'll see.
If you can see it from there, fine. Or to move the paper cups. Okay. I was able to complete the November statements. Got those out the other day. You should all have a hard copy of that. And just briefly on that, the numbers kind of fell back into normalcy from the high sales numbers of the summer. So just about kind of what we expected. So I don't think there was anything else in there that was out of the ordinary for the month of November. 9 months has gone by fast in the fiscal year. We have three left. So hopefully there won't be anything major that might impact the revenue for the rest of the year. A good snowstorm with a power outage for a week. We've had those before and it has a big impact. If there's any other questions on the November statement, if not, we'll get into the meat and potatoes here. Okay, so what I'd like to do tonight is kind of give an overview of the process of what we've done. I don't think at this time we get into any line item discussion or whatever. We have not met with the Finance Committee yet, and that's the time when we go through the review line by line and answer any questions there might be. But I thought it's a good point to show you
what we're doing in the background here, what thought went into a lot of decisions of what we do.
But we'll have a finance committee review before the next January meeting, so we'll have a finance committee recommendation.
Can we get to do all those bits?
Sure.
Okay. First thing I pop up, which you should have a copy, this is Pam's capital plan for the year and the next 10, for 10 years. And Pam works on this, and we massage this all year long. It's not just something as we're looking what we're going to do next year. Things change, priorities change during the year. So I think this update, Pam, is in the last
the latest,
2 days.
Yes.
So.
Well, maybe a week.
Maybe a week. But going through it, you'll see 2017 here, this is the current year we're in. This 2018 is the budget we're working on for the next year. So I go down to the bottom and I look at the things I need to know. Basically, what monies we're going to use, operational expenses. We've been building the IFR up, so next year she'd like to use $700,000 of the IFR fund. And what this does is allows us to keep the bonding down. So, I'll show you in a little bit the slow and steady approach we have, being able to put some money away, and so we don't have to borrow the big numbers. She has projections of bonds over the next, basically a bond every 2 years.
Actually, on this one, just to point out, the dark green is the bonded projects.
Right.
That are recommended.
It's easy to see to the copies you have in your folder, but the projects up above in the dark green relate to what would be used for the bonding. The $1 million in the light blue are things that are basically things that we can't use bond money for, such as vehicles or elevators and things like that would come out of our reserves.
Can I just ask you about the elevator, or do you want to ask about that later on?
You have a separate item, huh?
Yeah, it is a separate item.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay, I don't know if you want to give an update on where we are with the elevator.
It's on the agenda, I think, later.
Yeah.
It's
on the agenda.
Later.
It's on the agenda later.
Yeah.
Okay, so let me ask then about Demo Nyatt WTP, Child Street WTP, that totals $2.2 million. Ultimately, what is that?
It's to demolition of facilities when we no longer use them. Actually, Nyatt Road hasn't been used in years, but we maintain the facade just to make it look good. But it is deteriorating, and at some point, it's got to be taken down.
And how much is it to demo that? We're not using it at all.
No, it's an old treatment plant.
Right.
We had three. It was a well field that ultimately had saltwater intrusion.
So it's useless.
It's useless.
And the cost to demo it is how much?
It's a guesstimate, $500,000 to $600,000.
That seems like a lot of money.
It's a much larger facility than you would think it was. It's very large. You've got to look at asbestos issues because it was built in the 20s, I believe.
So we haven't got any estimates to demo it.
No. I've got a general estimate to do the treatment plant, and that looks about $1.5 million to $2 million, just to demo that.
Have you looked at a controlled implosion as an alternative?
I have not looked at anything on it. Just put it in there for something down the road in the future, just so we have something in.
Okay.
And the town occasionally makes noises when you're going to do something with this.
We'd be happy to deed it to them.
You understand. There, we put the fire out, but the town gets, when are you going to do something?
Is the land of any value that it sits on?
No, pretty low. Which
pretty low. It's wetlands all behind it.
Right.
It's a lot of pipelines in the
in there that run through the pump station. Our pump station sits next to it.
They got one house lot up front anyway.
It looks like a house.
It's at least one house. I mean, how much land's behind it?
Right. And behind it are a couple of huge concrete tanks.
Yeah.
Which we may or may not demo in the future.
Our tanks?
Tanks.
No, our, they, we belong,
they
belong
are ours, yes.
Is there a big environmental concern in when we, if and ever we demo it?
We do demo
the demolition?
Well, there will be.
There will be, yeah.
Right near the pond.
Yeah, it's all wetlands.
Yeah,
right,
I know
here,
that.
Right,
you put that pond there, right behind it.
Yep.
And it's a brick building, isn't it?
Yes.
So it's not like you can have the fire department, you know, burn it as a demo.
No, I would look into a controlled implosion as an alternative. It may not
I don't think it's that big. Well, there's a residential property.
It's
only like
yeah,
a
it's
already
it's
built.
Adjacent
they,
to
they
one of the wealthiest
properties
neighborhoods.
In the middle of downtown Boston. So I'm not saying
yeah.
it will work. I'm saying it's an alternative to look at.
Bay Road.
Yeah. Definitely when we get to that point, we'd have somebody look into all the alternatives and what would need to be done, what needs to be done for people.
You know, what Gina said about painting it without, somebody might take that property and do their own demolition on it.
If they see some land out there.
It's one of the priciest neighborhoods in town.
Why not put out an RFP and see the response?
That lot will go for about 200 empty. And there'll be some person who wants to do historical renovation, use the shell and the frontage. I've seen weird things happen. They did that at
the fire station. Station.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Sure.
And there'll be people in Barrington, especially in that neighborhood. It's a quiet, I lived five houses from there years ago, and it's a very popular neighborhood, busy street. But
mm-hmm.
It's worth asking the question.
Mark, could I ask you a question on
sure.
bonding? We're going to be doing, what, $10.4 million for bond?
Yeah, I'll get to that.
Okay.
I'm going to go over that. Pam's kind of...
Go ahead, if you don't answer my
Pam's
question.
Pam's kind of sketched out on what she thinks she's going to need.
Right.
Okay, then I go back and look at the debt service. So the next thing I do... this is a 20-year debt service... you can see this. Let me go back. This was last year, ending. Our total debt service was 3.2 million, and you remember we borrowed 8.3 million from TD Bank, but we didn't want to bump that debt service up too high because. It creates that the thing with our ratio and whatever.
Right.
So when we started this 2 or 3 years ago, we decided to capitalize interest and all the payments for 2 years. So that ended, and we did it to end in conjunction with the payoff of the bond we just had. So we understand how that. So we get into this doesn't work like mine.
You say the bond we just had.
Yeah.
The paid off the.
We paid off the bond of where we purchased the authority.
Okay.
30 years.
Right.
So I don't know if we're having a bond burning party or or what. This is the current year. You can see on December 1st, I made that final payment, $1.3 million. But I also, this year, made the first payment of principal and interest to TD Bank, which was a total of $452,000. And the interest payment this fiscal year was actually paid under the capitalized interest, so that's just half of it, the P&I payment that's due during the year. So that, with that payment in, brought us up from 3.2 million to 3.7 in this fiscal year, okay? So we want to try to keep around that 3.2. So as we go to the next year, this is the year that we're budgeting right now. You can see TD Bank come in with roughly $100,000 worth of interest in March, $457,000 in September. So that's $550,000 that we've added in really for the first time in this coming fiscal year, which brings up, so we lost $1.3 million, so we're going to be at the $2.5 million
for this coming year. We thought at the time we would have another bond in this year, but it looks like we're going to try to hold out as long as we can without to borrowing rather too soon and pay the interest on it before we get the projects going. And we've talked to TD Bank and our bond attorney, and what we can do is borrow from our own revenue fund and then do the bond and pay ourselves back. And it'll give us longer period of time to use that money because you really, they wanted to use it within that 24-month period. So there's really nothing in 2018 for the new bond. But as we go to 2019, as I told you in the letter, we make our final payment on the pipeline bond. And we also take out a new $11 million bond, which coincides with what Pam had for $10.4 million. So you always, to net 10.4, you got to borrow a little more because you got to put some reserves, cost of issuance, all the things Ray looks at when we do a bond. So I kind of averaged them up. I called the First Southwest for an estimate of what they think the rates are going to be. And we use 3.25 as an estimate percent for the bonds, this first bond. So we're probably going to do it in August, September of the coming year, but there'll be no debt service on it until probably March or April, which will be in FY 2019. So this shows the first payment on the new bond, which would be $748,000 a year. All right, so we made the final payment on this one. We pick up this one. So we're still hanging in FY 19 with that 2.3, you know, again, these are estimates, and around 2.3 to 2.5 probably debt service. As we go further, this would be the second year under that bond. And we drop down to $2 million, which this allows us with our revenue stream to be able to put a lot of that money in the IFR fund, in our reserves. And we'll see that when we project out. When we go to 2021, the next bond would be a $13 million bond. So these start to get added into the debt service. So we're back up to 2008. And if we go into 2022, the third bond comes in 2023, a $16 million bond. And I think the assumption of these bonds are doing Pawtucket. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. So everything's subject to change. So a lot of what we do, these are like placeholders to put in for what we think we're going to be doing in the next 10, 20 years. And this will go out to 2024. We're creeping up to that $4 million mark in debt service. This shows when these bonds are paid off. We've got 2029, 31, 34, 37. So, during that period, we're going to lose just about all the old bonds, and we'll get to the point where we have basically the new ones. So we go to 2025. The fourth bond comes in that we will probably do in 2023, August of 23, which is FY 24. First payment in FY 2025.
Why does the level of bonding drop so dramatically?
Well, this is based on the projections that Pam has in her capital plan.
But I'm just saying, won't there be another capital plan that will continue to go further? Isn't there a lot more to be done? We're not nearing the end of the upgrade.
This overall is a 20-year capital plan.
Okay.
But a lot of the major work that we're looking at, the Pawtucket Pipeline, the renovation of the pump stations, the construction of a new pump station.
The high service area.
A lot of the major projects will be essentially done in the next 5 years. So it's a 5-year time frame. After that, it becomes more of a maintaining the main water. water main replacement projects and going onward with those.
But why, okay, I understand that. Why wouldn't we continue that then at a faster pace? Is there some advantage in dropping that down, or rather, why not keep that at 12 or 13 million and keep going at that point?
We can do that, but again, you'd have to be looking at the amount of project work that we'd be doing and what you can actually accomplish.
Okay.
When you've got a few roads torn up at the same time, you see just doing a small section of Metacom really took a lot of our manpower and a lot of our time and effort, even though we had a contractor doing the work. You can't be doing too many of those at the same time.
And you don't know what's going to come up in the future.
That's
exactly.
Unexpected.
Right.
I can guarantee next year is going to be different from what we're showing.
Exactly. This is my best estimate of where I think we're going to.
Understand.
We need to focus our funds.
As an aside, when Barrington was doing its overall sewer project, at one point, we had so many contracts going, you couldn't get across town. You were stuck because there were different projects going around. You could not get across town in the process.
Right. The main purpose of this is to make sure that we can afford to do this.
Right.
With the revenue stream, our expenses, and which I'll get to the next.
I guess my point of even mentioning it is that we've been embarked on a long range program to do what should have been started long ago. And that's the failure, I think, of every municipality is taking care of its infrastructure. And we're finally saying we're taking care of our infrastructure. We have to do this. Otherwise, if we delay it, it comes back to bite us in spades. And so we mustn't let up on any of that. We've got to keep going constantly to do that. Because it's a worthwhile endeavor. Otherwise, the system gets worse. Anyway, go ahead, please.
This brings us up for up to 2027. So I'm not sure any of us will still be here at that point to be on the board or working here, but
or alive.
We hope all to be here. Right?
Right. Or alive.
But
the idea is we did a 20-year plan because
right. What
we do now is definitely going to affect where we are 10 years from now, especially as far as how much we're doing in bonds and how much we're saving in our reserves. Will make a big difference in just a few years down the road.
The important thing on the plate right now is our budget for next year.
Right.
And this is a projection of unless we do the bond earlier than August or September, this will be our debt service for next year. So
coming down considerably.
We go to the next phase of this, and I keep this all updated. You can see when I pay the bond, I have it paid, so I still have January 1st, I have $17,000 due on the 2012 refinance, and that'll be it for the year, so I know what my debt service will be. All right, we get to, let's see, right here. This is the interesting part. This is where we look at this is our current budget we're in this year, the FY17 budget. Last year we had a 3.25 increase. It was approved by the board on 2.2. And we go down, this is what we expect in the budget, 12.5 million revenue, 8.3 in expenses, the net income after expenses of 4.1. This matches the debt service that I have, 3.7. We're expecting to use cash for $860,000 of capital projects, and which gives us basically, if that all fell into place, we would have a net income of a loss of $411,000. But we know we've had a very good year revenue-wise, so that's not going to be there when we look at the final numbers. So that $400,000, we look at the revenue fund at the beginning of the year, $5.6 million. That's broken down into, at the beginning of the year, we had $4.9 million. In the general revenue fund, we had moved $500,000 to the IFR, $250,000 to stability. Then what happens if according to our budget last year, that loss would bring the revenue fund down to 5.2, which would reallocate the revenue fund. We added 500, we're going to add 500,000 to the IFR to bring us to 1 million, plus add 100,000 to the stability fund to 350. So you can see these numbers at the end of this year are going to go to the beginning balance over here for FY18. Okay?
Excuse me. What exactly is the stability fund?
We talked about that when we did the strategic plan, that currently we have on file with the U.S. Bank, the trustees, 3 months worth of, 60 days worth of money to pay expenses if our revenue was cut off.
Okay.
So we have $1.35 million in a O&M reserve fund. We want to bring this up another 30 days.
I remember.
To bring us up to 90 days.
Do we have business interruption insurance?
Do we have it?
Yeah.
We do have business interruption insurance.
And how long does it cover interruption?
I don't know the coverage off the top of my head, but it's fairly substantial.
If we do have that, it would seem to duplicate the stability fund.
Yes or no, there's probably some overlap there. I'm not sure it's going to provide that much money, but...
it depends on what the business interruption insurance is, but if it's...
Right, there is a rider on that for that. I can find out and let you know what that is.
Could you come back to us at our next meeting and so we have understanding of whether
we're
paying
twice? But I'll explain to you, the revenue fund, we've divided into these categories, all right? There's no limit that we can move from one to another. This is money that's non-restricted, that we can spend as we want. But it's an integral part to keep that at a fairly good level as it comes in your debt service ratio, that we use that as a starting point of what we have in the revenue fund on our debt service ratio. So it's important. I think when I started here, we had about 800,000 in the revenue fund. We built it up to about 5 million, which creates that nice number of debt service that we squeaked by, I think, the year before I came, at 1.26.
Isn't it 125%?
1.25 is the required minimum.
Yeah, that's time. That's not a percent. That's 1.25.
It's not a percent. It's a ratio.
Right. So the
it's percents there.
Percent.
That's a misnomer. It's,
right.
You don't have anything on the keyboard that says ratio.
It's a ratio. That's correct. It's not, the wrong label is on there. Let me go back to the topic again to begin the year. So we take the current budget we're in, we say, okay, if we're looking at a slow and steady rate increase, and I'll show you the impact of why slow and steady is better. So as we go over to the years, we're looking at the 3-4 range over the next 10 years, and then what it does, the 3% basically gives us that much more money. But I also factor in a adjustment for conservation less demand. I put 5% in this year because we're about 5% over because it was such a dry summer that we wouldn't have that 5% for this coming year. Like I said, adjusted for the dry FY 2017. So, instead of our usual revenues, sales being off by 1% or whatever, right now we're up 5.5%. But you can't count on that every year. So you see here, I just say, based on a normal year as we go out, we're going to do that. So if we take back that dryness, we're gonna take back an adjustment of a minus 5%, which is 300 grand. So the increase is going to of 345,000 is going to be offset by us dropping down 300,000 because weather conditions or whatever this year that made us unseasonably high in revenue. So we're probably going to come in, we're looking at you know, budget-wise with a 3% increase, just about the same as we had budgeted in revenue in this current year. Then we get down to expenses. Okay, I've, in our first draft, preliminary draft of the budget, I think we're going to have a zero increase in expenses. Okay, we've tightened up, we've saved a lot of money this year. We knocked out flood insurance, which was like $20,000 because...
That's right, on the building.
Yeah, because nothing, it only covered the building down there that we had lawnmowers in.
Right.
That we can move those out. So our insurance company did a review and they recommended the same thing. That's kind of a waste of $23,000. So we have savings there.
Can I just ask a question about that?
Sure.
Have we had the same insurance company for some years?
We've had the same, but it goes out to bid every year to different companies.
I think that was a great thing to make that change, but I'm wondering why, if they came through and agreed that that was a good thing to do, why they hadn't suggested
well,
it earlier.
We have a pretty good relationship with them. When I sat down with them, they said we can't argue the fact that.
So they didn't come up with
that. I came up with it.
Yeah.
The floodplain maps were just recently changed.
Right. We pulled up the floodplain maps here. We had them in. And
they've gotten worse. They haven't gotten better.
I found them for insurance.
Not here. It actually took the treatment plan out of a section.
They're all different.
Okay. We were paying a lot of money for not a lot of coverage
we
had. So
we
also went back, I think, 75 years and looked at all the hurricanes we've had. The water never reached that building, even in 1938, 1959, some of the big hurricanes. So I'm fairly confident that that was a safe thing. We've also saved in the change of the banks, which we've mentioned before. Bank of America, our bank fees last year were $21,000. Our new bank, Webster, they look at all the monies we have in there. Last month, my fee for the month was $190. So we're going to, for a full year, this will be half a year with Bank of America. And I think it was $11,000 or something for the first 6 months, but we're paying roughly $200 a month. So we're going to save $19,000 in bank fees.
When are customers going to be able to pay through ACH?
That's coming when we get the new portal. It's in the design stage right now. I would say by end of first quarter, we should be all good for ACH. So that should be all set. We also saved money insulating these two buildings. I think Ken gave some information months ago. I think it cut our heating and cooling bill about 40% with the insulations we put up in the attic. It's amazing, you know, how much we can spend. So you add those all up, it saves us a lot of money. And you'll see a lot of that in the budget. So if we flow down in this budget year, we're looking at $4.2 million net income after expenses. Debt service went down to 2.5. Using $1 million of cash for capital projects, leaves $721,000. We add that to our beginning balance down here. The beginning balance, add the 721. Pam has in her capital plan to use $700,000 from the IFR. So it's basically 5.2 plus the 7 minus the 7. At the end of the year, of the budget year we're looking at, would be 5.3. So we've taken the million, we've used 700,000, but we put in 800,000 to bring it, so it ends up at 900,000 for the year. Add another 100,000 to stability. So we've really kept the revenue fund at that level. So this process goes on. We have a very healthy ratio of 3.8 at the end of this year. The 2.64 we had said for this year is pretty close. I think on my report, we're at 2.8 or something like that right now. All right. So this process continues. These numbers fall up here. We go to 19. We look at an increase. We're looking at a normal reserve. But these are the key. I can change these numbers on the fly, okay, which I'm going to do right now to show you. I shook you out with the 10 years. If we do no increase this year, no increase, we just showed it. If we did no increase for 3 years, which financially we could probably afford it, but what it does, look at the ratio that's going to come back. We start to get dangerously low.
Yeah.
In this year.
9 years, we're no longer here.
In this year, which means instead of these 4% we got to do, we got to go up 6 or 7. Okay? To keep this. And that's not that far away. We're looking 5, 6 years ago. You know, by skipping a rate increase, and I think we agreed that it makes sense.
Well, 1% is 115,000, roughly.
1%, we're doing like 12 million, so it'd be like 120,000.
Okay, and so what would it be if you went to 3.25%?
For this year?
How does that, yes, for the coming year, how does that help smooth the future to try to get away from the higher ends further out?
Yeah, here, so let me put in what we had, so then we can.
Yeah, yeah.
Or the margin out.
We had 3.
By bumping in a quarter, it will affect.
And then we had 3.25. And then we had 3.50. Okay, that's the model we started with.
Okay.
Okay, and then you can see that ratio.
Right. What would happen if you go in at the same we went in this year, 3.25, if we, for the coming year, 3.25 instead of 3.
Well, you see, this tells you how much 3, for this right here tells you what 3.
Right,
what
3.25,
if you want to instead, brings it up.
What he wants to know, and correct me if I'm wrong, Al, he wants to know if we raise it now, how much will it reduce
that
the...
That 40% compounds over the 10 years.
How much, that's the question.
So if you want to see what it does, and yeah, it kept that up, you know, higher than it was. Let's see, 3.18. The original model was 3.1 was the ratio. 8.5. We picked up $300,000 in 10 years by that 0.25% this year.
0.25%.
Right? Because
300,000
at 3% after 10 years was 8.5 million.
0.25% is, you're telling me, correct me if I'm wrong, by paying $30,000 more this year, it will earn us $300,000 in 10 years because I want to invest my money there. That's a 10 times ratio in 10 years.
That makes no sense.
That's right.
It compounds and compounds.
I appreciate that.
But 0.25%.
That can't be right. You with me on that? It can't be right.
Yeah, it all depends upon the rate at which it compounds. And if it's compounding at the 3.25%,
the 3.25, if it compounded 10% annual, you wouldn't go up 10 times; you'd go up 2 or 3 times. So that's confusing to me.
Yeah, it's confusing.
But there's a lot of different numbers.
Right, exactly.
This is the revenue fund at the end of that. If you go back to...
You're starting with how many dollars? And you're compounding at 3.25% annually for 10 years. How many dollars?
My increase by 0.25% is $30,000. Because it's 120,000 is 1%. So 0.25% would be $30,000. So you're putting in $30,000 more this year. How much will it reduce our liability in 10? That's the question.
Well, it's 30,000 over 10. If it stayed the same, it would be 300,000, right?
Yeah, but you need...
But it's compounding.
At what percentage?
So the 0.25 is going to give you
Yeah, it doesn't.
It would have to be at 100% compound interest.
I think that's an error in the model.
I think that you need, that can't be right.
No, it doesn't pass the gut test.
It will be beneficial. It will compound. It may do good things. It can't do 10 times in 10 years.
Unless you're making assumptions that it's 9%
increase over any investment in 10 years.
You can. If you're getting 9% of your money, then that number will work.
We're just doing a straight.
1,000%. 1,000, 30,000, 300,000, 9%.
Well, I think we have time to review that with the finance.
Let me just say, we picked up the 0.25% that gave us $30,000 more dollars.
That I agree.
Okay, that 0.25 lives every year, giving us $30,000 more dollars.
But you're not raising the assumptions on the outlying years.
But now you're adding another 3.25%, then another 3.5% on top of that.
Okay. Still.
No, but that brings us to the 8 million.
That's the compounding. Is that you increase the budget this year, and you get 3.5 the next year, you get 3.5 of the current balance.
That 0.25 of rate increase produced $30,000, say, next year.
Yes.
But that 0.25 doesn't exist for the next 10 years. So that 30,000, we're starting $30,000 lower.
I don't think it's productive to argue about it here.
Yeah, let's go into that.
I think you've got too many other factors in there.
Well, there's a lot of things that happened, during those 10 years.
I raised the issue for several reasons. One is, it always looks great. You lower the rates. Everything else is going up. It's inevitable, and we have a huge nut to crack. Just as we have had things happen to us and to our system that we never counted on and we had to deal with, I expect things will happen. Even if the projects, these huge projects that we have projected to deal with over the next 5 years, could anyone say they're not going to be overruns or problems?
Is your concern that we won't vote for a rate increase?
No.
Okay.
No, we're going to vote for a rate increase. I can't believe we wouldn't.
No, but I agree with you.
But I'm saying I'm in the interest of keeping things as steady as possible down the line. I guess that's what I would say at this point.
Well, based on that analysis, and there's three things that are definite: death, taxes, and a rate increase by the BCWA.
And we have said that.
But
for several years.
Because we have so much deferred maintenance.
That's right.
And I understand, but I thought in previous plans, there was a time when the rate increase would be zero. I don't see it here.
No.
I mean, I couldn't
no.
be wrong.
Not any of my plans.
No.
Unfortunately.
So by design,
that's...
No more than
I just showed you, if we took
no,
it
no,
out...
No, I understand.
If we took up the increase for the next 3 years, we could live. I said, we could live by it. But... our kids are going to pay for it in 10 years.
I'm just talking 1 year.
Now, let me throw the counter argument, because Alan's point is well taken, is that if you put money down, you can lower the increases, whatever amount of money, it will have a positive effect on future increases. And we all agree that any increases that we have should be more or less stable, and we shouldn't have the wild swings. The reason I came on the board was I was upset that there was an 11% increase, and there was a statement that from now on it's going to be 4% every year. I said, gosh, we should be able to do better than that. We can. Not as much as I would have thought before I looked at the numbers, but we can do better than 4% every year. There will be things that happen. But the argument that you made that we could afford the zero, but we shouldn't do it, is absolutely right. But it's the counter argument to Alan. The 3% is the middle of the road pick. It's not the zero, and it's not putting too much away for the future, but it leaves us solvent should something unexpected come up. That's how I view it. You know what I'm saying?
It leaves us with the ability to use, bill that IFR fund.
Right, which reduces the borrowing.
Reduces our bonding.
We know we have to do all these projects. We're talking roughly 17% increase over the next 5 years. How does that put us comparable to any other water?
Way behind.
We're less.
That's what I want to get an opinion from somebody there. Because there was a time that all yelled and barked that we were
right, way ahead. But we're not going to have a thing like Newport with the 25% increase.
No, I understand.
Providence.
In 1 year.
Providence has actually asked for a 7.5% rate increase. Right now we're down to around 4% on the wholesale side. And that's included, we've been very aggressive about doing projects that will save us money, that we feel we don't have to raise the O&M expenses this year, even including the Providence
rate. So we have to be able to tell our rate payers, this is what we're doing for you.
Yes.
At this price compared to what everybody else is doing.
All you gotta do is get a list of what the rate increases of the other agencies have been over the last 5 years, or 4 years since that 11% bump.
And then just
show they went up 12%, we went up 3.25%. They went up,
I know there are gonna be some people don't care.
You're never gonna sell everybody. Never, mm-hmm. ever,
the
ever.
The general opinion is that we raise rates to line our pockets and make money, for lack of a better term. Our philosophy, as long as I've been on the board, is you raise the rates to meet your
demands.
And I think that's been steady across the board. We're a nonprofit. The shareholders in this business is every ratepayer. And the onus is on us to say if we're gonna raise a 3.25%, this is where the money's going. And we tried over years going back, and now it's aware of the old time. We tried not hiring staff. Don't hire that. We'll double up on that job and don't raise the rates. And 2 years later, the system went down the toilet. And instead of paying $2 million 2 years ago, we're paying $6 million 2 years later.
Tell you why. Well,
been there, done that. It doesn't work.
The other thing is, if you don't raise rates for 2 years and then you raise them by 6% or 9%,
then
people are going to be furious.
Oh, yeah. Right. And you've got a couple of fixed problems in the system. You've got a declining revenue on an average base of 1% that has to be compensated for. You've got employees that have to get at least small raises, and we got away with it for many years, and now we're paying a little more. It's still not extravagant, and those things have to be figured in. And then we've got Providence Water, which really have so much control over what they charge us for the water.
As a director, I'm satisfied that we're dotting the I's and crossing the T's. It's just that there's a certain populace out there that believes that we're rolling your money, you're giving a raise to everybody.
If you're on this board to be loved, you're in the wrong place.
That's right. Get a golden retriever.
When I look back at what we faced, we were probably raising rates when everybody else didn't. And that's why we got but they didn't have a bond to buy the authority. And they didn't have a pipeline bond that we had to cover. We ended up not doing capital projects to cover the cost of those bonds. So we had the 9, we had the 11. But we've kind of got that settled out now. You know, I call it slow and steady.
Was one of our big problems. We spent 90% of our time trying to tell the people that that's what our problem was. We had these bonds that meet and all this. So the minute you said raising a rate, they don't understand it.
Well, I always say, did the cable raise your rate? Yes.
Everybody
raises your rate. That's
yeah, but going forward, we really need to do a better job in letting the board know exactly what the money's going into. They have to know. I mean, they see the work going on. We really have to reinforce that.
They're beginning to understand.
That's a good point. We have this big project on Mattaconk. Wouldn't it have made sense to have a sign posted that says that the Bristol County Water Authority is investing $2+ million to improve the water service in this area?
Really? That's what it is. That's a lot of PR. But
that's great until the time where they do something wrong and ties it around.
They'll still comply.
To that point, you go to the Bristol Council and talk about Medicum Avenue to a person and say, every question we ask, you answer. You kept us well informed. The project that took place in Bristol, the appointing authority in Bristol was satisfied that any question they had, I mean, they were brought up to speed by Pam, by Sue, before the project started. So they sat there and said, we can't yell at you. They were very happy. To a person, they said, listen, the project is, I know what's going on.
And that project went extremely well, as most do. There will always come a project, as the unexpected happens.
Oh, yeah.
And all it takes is one. Mm-hmm. The thing that is the selling point to me as far as how do you sell the rate increases is Well, we have rate increases because we are doing our repairs and maintenance. And that has to be done because you've seen everywhere where it's not being done. And we have a very well thought out, detailed, ongoing plan to get everything done in an appropriate time and still only have a 3%. I think it can be solved. I think that's something we can do.
You know, it's easy for us to say, talking amongst ourselves, but sit in the gym or the auditorium at Bristol Warren High School with a couple hundred people out there and you see what a difference it is. You
right.
Try to sell that.
I've been in front of more than my share of angry crowds, I assure you.
But that's the point. You can't
we're
do
selling
it.
The landlord thing.
You can't do it at a point in time. You have to do it over.
The appearance of the vision. All
right. That's,
okay, let's keep right, going.
I'm moving on. So I'm just going to go through the process.
Just hold on a second. Let me just carry on. It makes sense for us to let the ratepayers know and anybody that goes to the East Bay where their money is going rather than saying Providence is up, Newport is up, Woonsocket is up.
Exactly.
Because they don't care what they're doing.
Exactly.
It's not like National Grid where you raise the electric and everybody pays the same.
They need to see a direct benefit.
Correct.
I think they need to see
system.
Both.
That's why I think we should consider putting signs up when we have projects like
sure.
Metacom with the total amount of the project, the timeline that we anticipate, and that this is an investment to improve service.
Yeah.
For the Bristol County
that's
Water.
That's what our governor is doing.
The mailing.
That's right on our bridge.
Any rate paid.
Instead of bridge, put that up.
Listen, newspapers are free, the website is free.
Well, anyway, keep going.
Okay, well, I'll move ahead. This, I think everybody sees the concept here of how we look at the rate and what the debt we have to cover. So, once we get this finalized, make some assumptions. This particular assumption is a 3% rate increase. I get into the meat and potatoes of the budget.
We haven't got that yet.
Not yet on that one.
Well, finance committee will deal with that.
Here we go.
We'll come back, and then we'll all look at it.
Yeah.
Right. First thing I do. I budget out payroll for the next year. I have everybody listed, all the administration, the women that work in the office, the guys across the street. We've added in Michael Crawford to replace Dominic in this spot. We have Peter Friera replacing Al Silver, Mike Watson replacing Brian Meller. And down below, I have all my retirees. I have my early retirees on what benefits they have on OPEB. Then I have my full retirees. These are under less than 65 years old. I have all my other retirees that are on a Plan 65 or supplemental insurance, and whether they're covered by, you'll note years ago, we cut out the life insurance that was covered till death. Now it goes away at age 70.
Right.
And we paid them a stipend for 5 years of those. We took it away. That's done. We just made the last payment on that. So if we go across, you can see. I'm hitting the wrong button here. This doesn't work like mine.
Come, it doesn't show.
What you see. So we have the current hourly, what the annual is. Again, just like last year, I put a placeholder in of a projected rate increase for management of 3%, subject to approval. Pam's increase is subject to increase per the award vote. And then we add overtime, what the total is, what FICA and Medicare cost, and then the total cost in here. Then we go over what health plan everybody's on. These are our new rates. Who has what? The dental, how much the employee pays, either 18 or 20. The older people were grandfathered in at 18. New employees since I came on have been paying 20. What the group life cost, total benefits for each employee, and what percentage that is of their salary. So administration benefits 22%, okay? We get out of the women in the office, same. Their benefits are a little bigger percentage because we're still talking about Blue Cross to Blue Cross, their wages are less. The guys across the street, benefits of 30%. That's just about an industry average of what benefits cost for everybody. So I basically take all the information from this by department, for OPEB, for the early people, the full retirees, and I transfer that information. Historically, that this year, you know, I'm around the 98th percentile of matching this budget in actuality. So this works. Okay. Then we get to the budget worksheet, which, if you remember, after 8 months, I said we use that as a guideline of projecting out what we think the year is going to do. Okay. So we project it out. All the numbers, this is the budget we're working in right here. This is last year's budget. So the numbers in here per the rate analysis that I just showed you, based on a 3% increase, that these were the numbers would come in at 3%. This equals what I showed on that before, the 12.591. All right. Then we get down to our projections on salaries by groupings, right through against. That's per the analysis. Sometimes one of the reasons we come in lower, that whenever anybody goes out, we've had a few of the women go out on extended the medical leaves, that they get TDI. So that TDI comes off what we pay them. We pay them, and then they turn in their TDI payments. So we're only paying, while they're out, basically a third of their salary, which comes under their incapacity pay or sick time or whatever. So sometimes this assumes that everybody's here the full time, not out on any medical leave or whatever.
So how much sick leave do people get?
The union gets 7 sick days a year, mm-hmm. plus for every year they work, they get a week of incapacity. So sick time.
But incapacity.
If somebody worked for 20 years, they would have 20 weeks of incapacity.
Yes, that's correct.
And we permit that to continue.
It's in the contract.
They will not budge on that. We addressed that the past 2 times. I
think before we go to another contract, we need to have a bullet point list of some of those issues,
yeah.
And we all need to spend time with the contract, because that's...
Right. There's some changes...
Do they get paid for that if they leave without having any left?
No, there's no pay for that. That's
okay,
not
so
a,
they would have to go out and be incapacitated.
They have to, they
it's
have
a
to be out
before they left.
It comes under similar to the Family Medical Leave Act, and it has to be a doctor's approved.
Right. For them to use incapacity, we require a doctor's letter, and we have the right to go get a second opinion. So it's not rampant that they're on it, but one of the women had a knee replaced or a hip replaced, and they're out 2 or 3 months.
Not just
that's what that covers.
Not just
the state covers 2/3 of their salary.
So
under the TDI
operators have had knee replacements as well.
Yeah. So
in any event, I think we need some hot buttons that we as the board look at before our next contract.
Yeah, we've done that in the past.
Yeah, we've approached that. Actually, new hires are treated different than the older.
New hires
are treated different on how that's done.
They still come in under the
same time.
But we don't pay them. The trick is new people.
Well, they have to be here 2 years before
right.
you're allowed, and then it's only 1 week
yeah.
per year that you've worked.
Right, and we don't pay.
Because it's pretty restrictive as to what you can use them for.
To get their makeup pay, the reason they always held it, that they would get paid, was a pension issue. And now 457 doesn't matter. New people can keep the TDI. We just would pay the difference. So, okay. In any case, we go through down, so So these are the things we're looking at. We moved some things around, added new categories, groupings, utility bills that are going to drop. So by category, this one, budget-wise, is going down 18%. This one's going down 23%. And this is just on drafts that we've got. Ken and the operations department are going through kind of line by line.
Do you have us still on quarterly for the coming year, quarterly billing?
Yes.
Okay, because we won't be ready to go till we have the whole system.
Right. Well, at least until all the traces are
okay.
Done.
Yeah. It's going to be, I don't know if we're going to do it piecemeal, but it's going to, until all those meters get in, that we're
right.
Able to do that.
Right.
Okay. Employee benefits, these numbers all came off that payroll analysis I showed you by groupings. I broke out the dental, the plan 65 used to be included in the group, but I broke that out as a new category. So this and this together would have been the 600 last year. Group life, pension fund, I'm looking at, you know, we decided to increase that up around that 500. I have 500,000 for next year. It's kind of a placeholder. 457 plan, you know, what it costs us to match, employee matching. COBRA receipts, when we have people on COBRA, they pay us the difference, then we pay them back 80% that are on retirement. Current employees, we collect back 18 to 20%, 101,000. And then retirees that contribute to their plan, 13,000.
Mark, I'm not finding this useful at all. It's hard to see up there.
Okay.
I'd love to see it on paper.
Well, that's why I'll move it along faster. And
but
I think when the finance committee
meets. We weren't going to do
a
line by line.
Is,
line.
No.
Yeah.
No.
It was just going to do a general.
In essence, we go through the whole thing. We get down to basically the match of last year, the 0%. You know, we're
I mean,
not
it seems
increasing.
To me that this amount of detail should go to the finance committee. We should spend a lot of time with it, and then we should bring it back to the board
right.
With our thoughts. But this is not a
I'm
problem.
Glad you told me to shut up because I get carried away.
Yeah.
I have suggested
we were just
going
to do a general
work.
Work.
Yeah.
But anyway,
yeah.
That's, I just
and
want
I don't
to
mean to be offensive because there's clearly hours of work in here.
No,
I appreciate
no, no, no.
That.
I want to, I thought tonight, just if you see the process, and that's kind of what I, yeah.
Okay.
We have faith in you, Mark. And him. Somewhere else here.
We're ready to move forward.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You need to give you the bump brush, Mark.
Merry Christmas. You know, this is exciting.
Mark, hold on a second.
Numbers guy.
Mark, it's a question from the government. We would have thrown out an hour. Come on, folks. Yeah.
Merry Christmas,
folks. Nina
has a question.
Which is computer expenses. We're running significantly over our budget.
Which ones?
Computer expenses.
Yes, we do. For what we had set up in the budget last year, we've done a lot more than we anticipated. Putting laptops in trucks is a lot of things that we did. Some software we brought in that we weren't expecting across the line. It might go down a bit next year. Randy's working on that right now. So.
Okay. That's what I assumed it was.
Yeah.
Thank you.
All right, we're on number 7. You gave us a sheet that supersedes the one that was in the packet, I guess.
Well, actually, right, goes along with it. This is, we did get an RFP for the architectural services for a new elevator.
Is this to replace the elevator that's outside?
Yes.
Handicap lift?
Yes.
And is it going to be another handicap lift?
No, this is going to be a full elevator. It's going to go right from the basement up to the second floor.
So it's going to be enclosed?
It's going to be enclosed. So it'll have easy access for people coming in the back. We're going to have actually an enclosed area off the back of the building that'll have a little vestibule coming into the elevator area. And they'll be able to come in directly up into the first floor here.
Is there any market to sell that used lift that we have?
eBay.
Perhaps.
Yeah.
never know. We were never operated it very successfully.
Right. Okay.
That lift has been a nightmare because it freezes up in the winter, doesn't move.
So the elevator doesn't go up and down. What's the problem?
Well,
so what's the total
escalator
cost of the elevator?
Comes stairs.
That's true.
I saw there was.
We have an estimate of approximately $200,000.
So I assume that because you loaded it with a generator, so if that's 180, I figured that it'd have to be about 200.
So we'll find out as we get a more in-depth design on it, but that's what we've been given as approximate.
So you're looking for a motion to award to architectural services?
Architectura.
Architectural.
Yes.
Well, do you need a motion on that?
Yes, please.
Is there a, what's the top number for their service?
And they're running at about 10% of the cost of the elevator.
Not to exceed 20,000?
We could do that for now, yes. If it's more than that, we'll definitely come back.
No kidding.
Let's make the motion.
I'll make the motion.
Okay.
Second.
And so we're adding not to exceed 20,000. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The ayes have it. Meters.
So if I'm reading this right, they come back with an addition to the original cost of the analysis that they performed for us because they had to answer additional questions, they had to respond to a complaint, and they had to attend other meetings.
Yes.
Okay. My personal feeling about their first presentation was it was of embarrassingly poor quality. Have they taken anything off for that?
I have to say they were not given much opportunity to answer any questions on that first meeting.
No, I'm talking about the presentation that came to the board initially evaluating the meter proposals, which have cited 2013 data and CNN reports on the potential sale of a company. It was embarrassing. And it didn't have a cost-benefit analysis, which is what it should have had from the beginning. So I don't know what they were asked to do, but the quality of what they presented was voluminous in nature in terms of pages and very lacking in logic, from my personal opinion.
Was that the only answer?
Yes.
I have to agree with that.
I'm afraid I have to. I would love to.
If I were sitting in your seat, I would go back to them and say to them, look, what was presented at the initial board meeting was not good, which is why this additional work was required.
Well, the additional work was in addition to the contract, because we initially did narrow the contract down a bit more than what they had originally proposed. As far as what they presented, it was just a recommendation for award. It really wasn't a full analysis of the it went through the steps of what we did.
The breakdown on the years was either too difficult for me to follow, which I'm usually pretty good at, or the numbers were completely wrong. But I couldn't follow it. And I'm usually pretty good at following such things. I could not follow what the numbers were.
Part of it, I think, was also the engineer who was here.
He seemed to be...
He did a terrible job.
He just seemed
but the
not,
written material was not of high quality. It was not...
It was basically logical. That presentation that sort of scrapped it and started all over again as to what we really needed for the meters.
You're right.
I mean, you hired them, Pam, I'm assuming, because this is their expertise.
That's correct.
Okay, so they presented... Did you say you hadn't seen that much paper since you were in college? Somebody made that comment.
Yeah. But the real person behind it wasn't here. The senior person wasn't here that night.
But if the senior person wrote what we saw, shame on them.
So why don't you do we need a motion to send it back and see if they'll take that into consideration and lower it up?
I'm happy to make a motion that as a board member I was appalled at the quality of their initial presentation. And it did not present a cost-benefit analysis, which is what I think they were asked to look at. Evaluate the alternatives and tell us which was the best and why.
Right. do this. Make a motion in one sentence.
I'd like to move that we ask our executive director to go back to the consultant and tell them we were dissatisfied with their initial presentation.
Fine. And to review the current bill of 49940.
With that in mind.
Okay. A second.
Second.
Is there a discussion?
I have a question on it. We sat here and listened to that. And we based a vote on that. On what they
initially.
No, not
we didn't do anything.
Well,
we sent it back.
We sent it back. We said it was inadequate.
Right. We didn't take action.
It was cut short, John.
We cut the because of
the second presentation I thought was, you know, certainly more informative.
Right.
When they came back and they had, I think they had the
and that's
higher
what
we
charged an extra $9,000.
If that's the case, then why did they bill us, period, if we weren't happy with it?
Well, I put it this way. They did the work. They paid their people. They are acting in, from their sense, in good faith. We're acting, there's a motion on the floor that says, hey, if this, of course, we have to pass this motion. If this motion passes, that's saying this is the feeling of the board of directors to whom you were hired to present this to. Please take a look at your bill. It doesn't say we're not going to pay a bill. It just says what it says.
We'd like to consider some consideration for the
right.
Poor information we got on that first.
Right.
Seven to take.
If we are being
meeting.
Billed for the second presentation, then I don't want to be billed for the first one.
Well,
we're being billed an extra $9,500.
Yeah, let's
I don't care whether they take something off the first one and bill us for the second one or what, but we did not get good quality for our money in my estimation.
Let us decide. We're going to vote on this, and then the outcome of the vote will determine what happens. There's further discussion. You ready to vote? Raise your hand if you're in favor of the motion. 1, 2, 3, 4. It is unanimous. Okay, so add that to the letter that is sent back to them. Let's see what happens. Water main extension.
Comment. If I were writing a letter to them or having a phone call, I would first go back to our RFP and remind myself exactly what it asked for. And if our RFP was faulty, then I think we need to know that and learn from it before we do this again.
Okay. Water main extension better. That's for you.
Yeah.
Do we want to talk about giving a contractor, instead of 5 years, give them 10 or 15 years
to recoup? Deal with that after New Year.
Move that forward.
Yeah. Keep it on the agenda.
North Farms? No. Warren Paving?
No.
Board correspondence? None. Next meeting is the 19th of January. You want to get a doodle? What are the dates that you would like for the finance committee?
It comes down to when Judith is available.
I'm available typically every Thursday.
All right, so we'll put in doodle on Thursdays, okay, in January, and let everybody know about it, because other people may want to come to your meeting, but you folks settle on it, and then you'll tell us when it's going to be, and other people, if they want to attend, they can do so. Okay? And the last item is adjournment. So Merry Christmas. Happy New Year.